Welcome to Keep the Faith, songs and stories to encourage you. I'm Donna Cruz, along with my friend Penny.
You probably remember where you were, what you felt, who was beside you, and what you resolved to do. 9/11 was a pivotal moment. And now, 20 years later, we remember not only the loss, but also the courage, the unity, the resolve, and above all, the hope. On Keep the Faith, it sounds something like this.
The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you.
And so they had said, Terry, part of your responsibility is that if there are people who have passed away, we're going to need someone to be able to talk to their kids. And I remember speaking to that young fella, and the first thing, I just wanted to let him know that his dad was a hero.
Matthew 18 talks about having a childlike faith. And I think I understand more about that having watched the kids. You know, they don't define themselves the way that I do. They just assume everybody's their friend. And, you know, these leaders assume these kids were their friends too.
I will trust in you.
Next on Keep the Faith, you'll hear from a man who was right in the thick of 9/11 as a comforting presence and voice of hope.
You hear me when I call. You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. My sword and shield, though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me, I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend. Always by my side. my side.
You found the home of contagious encouragement. Keep the faith.
I've heard you can take what's broken and make it whole again. Well, here's the pieces of my heart. What can you do with them? 'Cause I can't hold them all together anymore. So I let them fall, surrendered to the floor. You make
to Keep the Faith.
I'm Penny. Heroes come in all shapes and sizes, but none are more brave than those who work hard to keep us safe. Terry Johnson is a chaplain who served our country in many ways, including 20 years ago as a grief counselor in Washington, D.C. He reflects on those first moments of September the 11th, 2001.
My pager goes off, then my phone starts ringing at the house. Then my cell phone starts ringing, and then my fax phone, which I didn't even know the number for, started ringing all at one time. And I just remember thinking, what in the world? And I turn on the news, and that's when I'm seeing this whole thing unwind. And then I pick up my home phone, and they simply said, Terry, we're going to have a car for you. We need you to get ready that you've been activated. that there's an attack on the Pentagon. And so they had said, Terry, part of your responsibility, if there are people who have passed away, we're going to need someone to be able to talk to their kids. So I just remember the very first phone call that I received. They had talked to the mother, and her spouse had definitely passed away. And they said, well, we have someone to talk to your son. And I remember speaking to that young fellow. And the first thing, I just wanted to let him know that his dad was a hero, because that kid was 12 years old. And I will tell you, the thing that stood out to me the most is that I had a chance to meet that kid 8 years later. He wanted to know who was that guy that talked to him, of seeing that kid who was in his early 20s by that time, and him just saying how a difference that made, that he never forgot that his dad was a hero.
And as he looks back, it's easy to think about the bad, but he remembers more of the good that was born.
How people unified there in the city. I don't care if you're a Democrat, Republican, everybody came together, because you couldn't go to the grocery stores. And we were all cooking together. We were bringing food, and just whoever needed food. And it was just that part was just absolutely beautiful, of seeing Americans came together. And that lasted for a couple months.
I remember how you told me that life may not be easy, and everything that I need, you've already given me. I remember how you told me I can trust you completely. So why am I doubting when you prove that you'd fight for me? You've walked me through fire. I'm living out the victory. Doesn't mean I won't feel the heat. You've walked me through fire. Lord, how could I question when you prove that you'd die for me? You've walked me through fire.
Yeah.
hope only gets deployed in times of struggle. We only know the fullness of hope in times of struggle, because it's when we're drained of all misplaced hope that we understand that our only hope is in Christ, and that's where we are transformed.
The peace that passes understanding is my song, and I sing. My hope is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord. Yeah. My hope is in you, Lord.
This is Keep the Faith.
Karen Kingsbury shares how one of her books brought a family hope in the face of tragedy. Next on Keep the Faith.
I walk a bit different now, now that my heart's been found. Nothing really feels the same. I hold my head a bit higher, I lift my voice a bit louder. Yeah, something inside has changed.
I am a mountain mover, water walker, more than just an overcomer, 'cause I've been set free. I am a gospel preacher, heart on fire, freedom singer, testifier, 'cause I've been redeemed. I am a believer. I am a believer. I know this is not my home. I know I don't walk alone. No matter what comes my way, I have peace through the trouble. I have joy through the struggle. Now my hope's in a brighter day.
I am a mountain mover, water walker, more than just an overcomer, 'cause I've been set free. I am a gospel preacher, heart on fire, freedom singing, testifier, 'cause I've been redeemed.
Guys, my name is Luke with For King and Country, and this is Keep the Faith, the home of contagious encouragement.
Count to three and say a prayer. Down for love and up for air. Underwater, overjoyed. Water for a thirsty soul. Water for a thirsty soul. Baptize me into your love. Oh, my spirit's overcome.
I'm coming alive with you. I was living a lie.
people say,
listening to Keep the Faith.
I'm Dee Rodriguez. Out of the ashes have come great stories of hope. Karen Kingsbury has one to share. She's a New York Times bestselling novelist with books like the Baxter Family Series, Love Story, and One Tuesday Morning.
She was working in the financial district in New York City when the terrorist attacks happened. Her building was evacuated, and as she walked along, she saw the plane hit the second building. She saw horrific things that day, things that scarred her and depressed her and discouraged her and made her wonder if she'd ever be the same again. Well, years went by, she ended up having a son, and finally, as her discouragement became more than she could bear, someone gave her a copy of my 9/11 book, One Tuesday Morning. She read it and tears streamed down her face, and for the first time she felt like she could live and she had encouragement and hope again. She began to read my other books and just sort of fell in love with the stories. Well, as her little boy got older, he knew how important my books were to this woman, to his mother. He decided to use his money to buy 4 copies of One Tuesday Morning and take them down to the memorial with his mommy and hand them out to perfect strangers. This amazing little boy got hold of the books, and his mom did just that. She took him down, and he began to hand out the books. Now, I knew about this, but I didn't know what would happen or if I'd ever hear from the people who were the recipients. 2 days later, I get an email from another woman. She tells me, "Karen, I've never heard of you. I Googled your name, didn't realize you'd written these books, but I was under so much discouragement. You see, my best friend, my cousin, died in the attacks. I hadn't been back to the city. I couldn't get out from underneath the discouragement and depression. But this year, I felt compelled to go down to the memorial, and just maybe if I put my hand on my cousin's name, on the wall, on the memorial, maybe I would have some healing and some closure because he was my best friend." And so I went down and I fought through the crowds and my heart was racing and I reached the memorial and I put my hand on my cousin's name. And just as I did that, a little boy came up and tapped me on my elbow. I looked down and this adorable child gives me a copy of your book, One Tuesday Morning. I put it in my purse, read it on the way home, couldn't stop reading until I finished it, and now I had to write you to tell you that I had this enormous burden lifted off my heart. My cousin would want me to be happy and to live life, and because of your book, I feel my whole life has been changed.
I am surrounded on every side. Can't see the light of day, but I am persuaded beyond all hope, you won't let go.
Everybody understands hurt and loss. Whether you're a very religious person or a passionate pursuer of Christ or you've never darkened the door of a church, everybody deep inside just has to believe there's something better out there than what we're living right now.
Never.
Hello, I'm Ted Baer with your Movie God Minute on Keep the Faith. Resort to Love is an entertaining romantic comedy streaming on Netflix. Erica, a singer in New York, is distressed when her fiancé Jason calls off their wedding. Erica decides to move far away and start over at a resort on a beautiful tropical island. Ironically, she finds out she must be the resort's wedding singer and must sing at, you guessed it, Jason's wedding. Resort to Love serves as a good reminder that life comes with plenty of twists and turns. However, those twists and turns are less frightening if we placed our faith in Jesus, who consistently reminds us in His Word written in the Bible that we have nothing to fear. Resort to Love is delightful, but it does have some content cautions. Check out the full review at movieguide.org. Moving on is a not-for-profit organization.
This is Keep the Faith.
Visiting world leaders with your kids happens in dreams or in the life of Bob Goff. Next on Keep the Faith, he shares how you can do extraordinary things too.
We got a letter from the leader of Bulgaria, and he said, children, if you'll come to the palace in Sofia, I'll give you your interview. And they went nuts. They're like, no way.
When the solid ground is falling out from underneath my feet, between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. And when I'm feeling like I've been let down by my friends and my family, I can hear the rain reminding me. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. Of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor. When my sails are torn, your love surrounds me. In the eye of the storm, when my heart
hopes and dreams are far from me, and I'm running out of faith. I see the future I picture slowly fade away, and when the tears of pain and heartache are pouring down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control.
Yes, you do, Lord.
In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me.
And I just don't know how I'm gonna make ends meet. I did my best, now I'm scared to death that we might lose everything. And when a sickness takes my child away and there's nothing I can do, my only hope is to trust you. I trust you, Lord.
In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
You're listening to Keep the Faith.
I'm Donna Cruz. 9/11 is one of those markers in history. There's a pre-9/11 and post-9/11. For Bob Goff and his family, post-9/11 would be defined by dreaming big for a life of adventure. He shares about that in his books like Love Does and Dream Big.
When our kids were young, they were 7, 9, and 11 years old. That's when 9/11 happened. And so I told them this plane hit a building, and I asked, if you had 5 minutes in front of a world leader, what would you ask him to kind of make sense of your faith, your hopes, what your life is about? And so Adam was the first one to go, and he was 7 at the time. And he said, you know, if I had 5 minutes in front of a world leader, I'd invite him over for a sleepover. Isn't that great? Because, you know, when you're in a sleepover, you're big buddies. And Richard was 9 at the time, and Richard said, if I had 5 minutes in front of a world leader, I'd ask him, what are you hoping for? Because maybe I'd be hoping for the same thing. Who knows? And Lindsay was our precocious one, and she was 11, and she said, you know what? If I had 5 minutes in front of a world leader, I'd say, you know, if you can't make it over to our house for the sleepover, what if we come over to your house and videotape an interview with you and get a message of hope to pass on to other world leaders from you? Isn't that terrific? And we sent this letter out to everybody, probably 1,000 letters. And then every day after school, we'd go to the post office box and we'd be full of letters. In fact, like Tony Blair would say, like, jolly good show. He'd say, forget it, but jolly good show. They'd all be really nice, but they'd all say, forget it. But we got a letter from the leader of Bulgaria. And he said, children, if you'll come to the palace in Sofia, I'll give you your interview. And they went nuts. They're like, no way. And then the prime minister of Switzerland wrote back and said, if you'll come to Bern, we'll give you your interview. Then the president of Israel wrote and said, if you'll come to Jerusalem, we'll give you your interview. We got 29 yeses. Is that crazy?
Sometimes I wonder, is he faithful? Does he see me in my trouble? Does he understand? Sometimes I question if he's able. Can he rescue? Can he save me again and again? But when I look back, did he move every mountain? Did he part every
Sometimes those voices try to tell me I'm forgotten and I'm falling too far from his hands. But I know what kind of God he is, and I'm trusting in his promises. I'm believing and I'm singing, yes, he can.
Listening to Keep the Faith.
I'm Penny. Bob Goff and his family found themselves on the adventure of a lifetime visiting with world leaders, in large part because his kids thought it was actually possible.
The conversation they would have would be so different than the conversation they might have with me. Matthew 18 talks about having a childlike faith. And I think I understand more about that having watched the kids. You know, they don't define themselves the way that I do. They don't think about the things the way that I did at the time. They just assume everybody's their friend. And, you know, these leaders assumed these kids were their friends too. And they would bring them back to their offices and they would say, you know what, when I was your age, and then they would tell this beautiful story. There's one guy from the Eastern Europe, and he said that when he was growing up, his dad used to hide his hat in the woods and pretend that he forgot it, and then tell his son to go into the woods and get it. And he said, I was so afraid that the bears were gonna come and eat me up. And so he would whistle, and he would start whistling in front of the kids. And the kids would just be glued to what he was saying. And then he would slow down, he'd look them in the eye and said, you know, here's my promise to you. I don't tell any of my soldiers this, but I will never let the bears come and get you. Oh, man, the power of hearing somebody talk to young people and just that kind of promise. So at the end of these interviews, you know, you can't give these guys a box of chocolates. And so what we did is we had a little like ring box, and inside of it was the key to our front door. And the kids said, we really meant it about the coming over for the sleepover. And you know what? I won't tell you the name of the country, but one of these leaders wrote, and he wrote to my daughter and said, you know what? I'd like to come and use my key. And we said, come on over. And they did. I just want to live in constant expectation of what might happen. But to get there, we got to have a childlike faith.
This is Keep the Faith.
I'm Brandy Lene. Here's some contagious encouragement on Keep the Faith. The one who falls and gets up is much stronger than the one who never falls.
Who breaks the power? of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
To keep the faith.
Hey, I'm Reba McEntire. Challenges are always in front of us, but they give us stories of hope that can encourage others. Just call 800-726-4150 to share yours. We'd love to hear from you. That's 800-726-4150.
When I was as a firefighter in New York, when the towers came down, now, the towers were already down, and they wanted us to go in the neighboring buildings, the large buildings that where the subways were connected. So the Federal Express building, which was halfway devastated, a whole side of it was completely open to the air. All the offices, papers were flying out, stuff like that. And so they wanted us to go in the subways, try to reach people that may have been trapped in the subways. And now the power was out. We had no water pressure, and so I go walking into the lobby, and my legs wouldn't move at first. It went against everything in my body walk in that building. And I said, "Dear Lord, give me the strength." He said, "Just take the first step." So I did. I went walking in the building. As I was walking in the lobby, 10 firefighters came running past me screaming, "Run for your life, the building is coming down." I said a quick prayer, like, "Oh no," I think it was.
And how did that change your perspective after that on life itself?
Every day is precious. Every moment, every day, and trusting God.
You are not hidden. There's never been a moment you were forgotten. You are not hopeless. Though you have been broken, your innocence stolen. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send out an army to find you in the middle of the dark. It's true, I will rescue you. There is no distance that cannot be covered over and over. You're not defenseless. I'll be your shelter, I'll be your armor. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send out an army to find you in the middle of the darkest night. It's true. I hear you whisper, you have nothing.